beer, rum, and rock and roll. Saving rock, one conversation at a time. With Randy Legault and Beau Shiminsky.
You wanted the best, and you got the best. The hottest podcast in the world, beer, rum, and rock and roll.
Cheers.
Cheers to it.
Okay, man. What's new? How's it going? Haven't seen you in a bit. Anything new to report?
No, just same old, same old, working, busy. Kids are good. Actually, I'm batching for the first time in for a week.
Right.
And it's pretty cool. The silence.
Right.
The sound of silence.
It can be pretty awesome. Yeah.
It's weird to my ears, but I think they like it. I think they're enjoying the break.
I think it's healthy.
It's punishing when I go to work because I punish them. But when I get home, I'm
right.
They're off. It's really interesting.
See, that's going to happen to me in a couple weeks.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
That's happening?
Yeah, because what just happened was the family vacation,
which
is the exact opposite of what you're talking about.
Right.
So we went to my wife's parents have a cabin in northern Saskatchewan on a lake.
Yeah.
Cabin is brand new. Yeah. It's not a cabin. It's a house.
Right.
Three-bedroom house. Accommodations are tip-top. It's wicked. The nine-hour drive is not wicked. Right?
Yeah.
Like, I'm more condo pool than cabin lake. That's just where I'm at. I don't want anything to do with any kind of camping vibe. And this is a bit like that. Like the bugs, for example, we're fucking out of control. My tolerance is really low too, to boot. Like I'm talking mosquitoes, horse flies, fucking some bugs I didn't recognize, dude.
Yeah, yeah.
Like it was nasty that way.
Yeah.
So there was a couple shitty days where we had to stay in.
Yeah.
I was better there. No bugs inside. Right.
That is very true because I really like the thought of camping and I did it a lot with the family when they were young.
Yep.
Like with your kids' age, we were camping a ton.
Yeah.
It was economical.
Sure.
And we were going with groups of friends and it was just a kind of
right.
Awesome. Everything is so great about it. Everything except the bugs.
Yeah, right. It's just brutal.
It's just, I don't like it. You know, I don't like stinking like
doing this. Yeah.
Deet.
Here's my deal. If I'm bringing bug spray and a bear horn, I'm going somewhere I don't want to be.
Right. And
basically,
true, the bear situation, you know.
Why do I need a bear horn, Beau? Why am I where bears are? This is not sitting well with me.
Yeah.
I didn't see a
bear. Yeah, it's a young man's game.
It is.
It's a young man's
game. Anyway, I powered through, man, and it was all good. And now she's going back there because I'm one and done.
Mm-hmm.
She's going back with the boys.
Okay.
In a couple weeks, and it's batch time for a week for daddy.
Well, my wife and kids are in a trailer on a lake, but no tents, air conditioning, full situation there.
See, I had no AC.
Right on the water.
Yeah.
So there's a picnic table and then you walk into the lake.
Well, that's what this cabin's like. It's right on the beach.
Yeah.
Like it's mint.
Yeah.
Except no AC and the bugs.
Yeah. And the bugs.
Yeah.
Anyways, so they're doing that, and they're really, I think, liking it in the sense that they want to do it again, but have me out there, which is,
right.
I'm all for it, you know.
Right. I always say when they go away, like, just give me a heads up exactly when you're coming back so I can get people out of the house and clean it up, clean up the coke and get the hookers out.
Yeah. Wash all those clothes.
Yeah. Wash the bedding.
Yeah. All that. Clothes is code for bedding.
That's
just
right.
So you know.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Well, I've got another chapter in something, things I don't understand.
All right.
Like 4th of July was in the States a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
And this is what was the catalyst for me to bring it up because I've always thought this way. If I don't get the adult obsession with fireworks, I don't get this. Mm. Kids, I get. I don't get it. And that skyline shot of LA, did you see that? Of illegal fireworks going off was insane.
On the 4th of July, yeah.
Oh, yeah. It just looked like the city was exploding. And I'm like, it's fireworks. Who gives a shit? Like, I don't. Taking your kids to see it, I get. Do you get it? Like, is it just me?
I think once you've seen fireworks, you've seen fireworks.
Right.
Unless you've seen the odd video where somebody's got Stairway to Heaven cranked.
Okay, sure.
And they're doing this ladder that keeps this some crazy cool fireworks that are going off. Like that's something you want to see.
Okay, there's the odd exception, right? Perhaps, but...
Because I've seen that video and I'm going, man, that would have been cool to be there.
Mm-hmm.
But...
And I'm sure there's an art to it, but I just don't get it.
But it's a lot of bang, bang, same colors, shapes, yeah. Going high. You've seen it.
Yeah,
right? I get it, but sometimes.
But to light them in your backyard? What could go wrong?
Although, like, I got to say, back to the camping.
Yeah.
Going to this lake in Saskatchewan.
Yeah.
And that you can go to any gas station sure. on the way there and they yep. sell them, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm there with young Kale.
Yeah.
I don't know how old he would have been, 7? We're getting fireworks. We are definitely getting fireworks because they got a beach front there on the lake.
Yeah, I don't care what happens.
Oh, yeah. Here we are. My cousins, I don't know how many yards one way and I'm the other. We got Roman candle fights going on right now. You know.
Yeah.
It's
what could go wrong there?
It's awesome.
You're holding it in your fucking hand.
Yeah, I know.
We did it on houseboats too. Hot firework in your hand.
Like, yeah.
It's, yeah, and you're hammered to boot.
Yeah. I mean, you're not going to, well, you're not going to die, but it's.
People
it's
lose not, fingers every year,
they
man.
They can seriously harm your guitar playing, which yes. is not a good thing. Kids.
Anyway, that was my Randy doesn't get it moment.
All right.
Okay, man, let's get to the topic at hand. We're talking about Kiss. That's all we're talking about. Top 10
What
Kiss
gave that
songs.
Away?
Yeah. what could have tipped you to that?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was brutal, man.
Yeah.
Because I love so much of their catalog. I know every note of it, every syllable of it,
mm-hmm.
and I just love so many of their songs. So I had it down to 20, and I chipped it down to 10, and it was just brutal. It's like picking your kids or something. Like, it was just,
right.
it was fun, but it was agony at the same time.
The hard part for me was to turn off the kid that I was when I was
right.
getting into their music,
yeah,
and the adult that I am now who knows the importance of Kiss at that
right.
time.
And that's what I love about the band is it keeps you in touch with that kid you're talking about. Very much so for me anyway. Like they keep me in touch with my inner 12-year-old.
Sure. And the repetition was awesome to do again and again and again and again
yep.
because that's what I did way back when.
And I do not get tired of it. I don't know what it is about their music.
Yeah.
Maybe Rock and Roll All Night be an exception, but I don't tire of their stuff. Okay, man, are we going to do this or what?
Oh, yeah, baby. We're going to do
this.
Oh,
what's he got?
Okay.
Perfect. Okay.
Let's celebrate all that is great and magnificent.
I got something for you. Ready?
Yeah. I'm way off, Mike. Oh, you didn't.
You ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Hang on.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm doing the rest of the show in my Kiss Unmasked mask.
Oh, my God. The unmasked mask.
I can't breathe. I got to take it off. So I bought this for two reasons. One, it's a Kiss Unmasked mask. And if I have to wear a mask going somewhere, why not wear a Kiss mask? The second
right.
reason, I'm going to get this right. So I'm going to look down and read. 100% of the proceeds from buying this, I think it was like $30 or something.
Mm-hmm.
100% of the profit generated from the purchase of this Kiss face mask shall be donated to the Global Relief Fund for live music crews who are fucking hurting through Live Nation.
Sure, sure.
So I thought, hey, that's a win-win. There
hey.
You go. The Kiss Unmasked mask. I thought that was kind of cool.
Yeah, great.
There was a Destroyer one and some other one, but this made more sense.
Nice work.
Yeah,
I think you should keep it on for the rest of the show.
I'll hyperventilate. I'm too excited by this top 10. I'd hyperventilate.
Okay.
Okay, man.
All right, I'm ready.
Let's flip this Ace Frehley pick, which I believe, if memory serves, I was fourth row in 99 at the Millennium show at BC Place.
Okay.
Dude, you remember the Millennium when the world is supposed to end?
Oh, yeah.
I didn't care because I was fourth row center for Kiss.
Awesome.
It was wicked. And I think that's where I got this pick. But anyway.
I got one just like it. I just can't find it.
On the reunion tour as well, I bet. Yeah.
It was 96. I was right there, right in front of Gene, looking at the rolls.
Looking at the sweaty rolls.
Oh, my God. I digress. We want to celebrate, baby.
I'll flip this time.
Okay, you flip and...
Do you want the autograph or the Kiss logo?
Kiss logo, please.
Okay, ready?
And what's the winner get to choose?
You get to pick whatever you want.
We get to choose. Okay.
Got to choose.
Yeah, baby.
Logo.
You go first.
I go first?
Okay.
All right. Okay, coming in at number 10.
Okay.
From this album right here, released in 1977, Love Gun.
Gonna love with the cardboard cutout thing that came
Mine.
In it. How great was that?
I Stole Your Love, Christine 16. Got love for sale. Yeah. Blah, blah, blah. It's wall to wall awesome. Even then she kissed me, I love. But anyway. Okay, number 10.
This is off love gun. The first one.
No place for hiding, baby. Nowhere to run. You pull the trigger on my love gun.
Number 10.
Love gun. Love number gun. 10. Yeah.
Yeah.
This is the Paul Stanley song. He sings his ass off on the song. Well, he sang his ass off on all these. He's an incredible singer. I just love this song. It's the quintessential Paul song. I love the gun snare.
Yeah.
And Ace Frehley's fucking outro solo is look at that. Yeah. Goosebump City. Yeah. Have I mentioned I have his face on my left bicep? Yeah. He's going to be well represented here, by the way.
Yeah.
It's an awesome song. Paul plays rhythm on it. Obviously, that's what he does, plays rhythm guitar, and he plays bass on it. A little tidbit for you. And it's been played on every tour since that tour for good reason. And he's, for those of you who are maybe not that bright, he is singing about his dick.
I don't know if I caught that the first 200 listens, but I'm going to have to go back.
Do you remember Role Models? The Stifler and
Paul
Rudd?
Yeah, sure,
remember he's teaching that his young
right, because they're all dressed up and kiss. Oh,
this
yeah,
is Love Gun. He's singing, Paul Stanley's singing about his dick. It's awesome.
It's for only for the clever kisses.
Oh, dude.
Good choice, Randy.
Thank you.
Good choice.
Thank you.
The love gun.
I thought you might like it.
Oh, I do. There's nothing I'm not going to like. Mm-hmm. I can guarantee you that right now.
100%. What if Shandy's number two?
I'm hoping. The opening track of that said record we were just talking about.
Right.
From the love gun is a track that just comes out of the gate firing. I Stole Your Love.
Ooh. Yeah.
I love the pace. I love the energy. It's just out of the gate.
Yep.
How can you not dig it? The vocal is crazy good.
Yep.
That little shout out into the solo, guitar! It's like, yes, it's coming and I can't wait for it.
Yeah.
And Paul said this was inspired by Deep Purple's Burn.
I don't think I knew that.
He wanted some sort of speed track like that. And this...
Right.
This was one of their quicker ones for sure.
Yeah, it's a great opener.
It is. Yeah. Awesome. Awesome. Number 10.
Like, I remember buying Love Gun, and I remember dropping the needle on that song. You know, it's a badass song when Love Gun isn't the opening track.
Right.
It's track one of side two.
Right. And it wasn't a slow little track either.
No.
Like, you know.
Yeah. It's killing me. Yeah. It's an awesome song. Well, there's a reason this tour.
Yeah.
The Love Gun tour, that's the opening track. Not on Alive 2 because it's fake, right?
Right. Right.
Detroit Rock City is the opening track, but they opened that song for a reason.
Yeah.
It fucking rocks.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh God.
I got it out of my way because I was on the fence. I left a couple out here that I'm just gonna fucking cry about.
I'm in agony already.
Okay. 9 for you.
All right. From this album right here, Rock and Roll Over.
Wow.
1976. A to Z. This is probably my favorite album.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'm surprised at that.
Yeah. Favorite studio album. I mean.
Yeah. Okay.
Needless to say.
Sure.
But.
Sure.
Yeah, I think it's this one. It could change tomorrow, but yeah. Another Paul Stanley track. You can't fight, but tonight, there's nothing you can do. I want you. I want you.
Oh.
It's so awesome. Like the fucking, it starts off with that all mellow and then it kicks in with that fucking riff. And I can remember as a kid, do you remember Don Kirshner's rock concert?
I'm a little younger than you. That's
anyway,
the problem.
It was like one of the first shows to show.
Yeah.
It was live performances and videos and stuff. There's a video for this song.
Okay.
Lip synced. Like it's not,
sure.
You know, it looks live, but there's no crowd, that kind of vibe.
Right.
And it's just, I remember watching it and just, oh my God, this is awesome. And the solo, Paul starts the solo and then Ace just fucking takes it to another level.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, I just, there's a lot of cool dynamics in it. I just think it's awesome. Never love, never thought you could. Treat you right, girl, you know I would. You can fight for the night, there's nothing you can do. I want you. I want you. I want you. I want you. You can walk in a haze, you can travel till you die.
Yeah, rad song. Great vocal from Paul.
Yeah.
You know. And so... lyrically, the song is so him.
Want you.
Yeah, right. You know, it's just yeah. Look at me. We're gonna have sex. I'm just the star child, love guy. Yep. You know,
yeah.
With my gun, I'm ready to go. Yeah, it's a pretty great track for him.
I love the guitar in the verse. Down, like that. Yeah.
It's they have a way to choreograph this shit, man. Like the songs, it's so nuts because they're all uniquely them and. Most all these songs we're going to be talking about really have all that going on fully from the band.
And it made the live set. It's on Kiss Alive too.
Sure, sure. Okay, qualifier.
Yes.
They can be studio tracks or live tracks.
Live is up for grabs, man. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
So there's something about Kiss for me as a kid. This was my first record and it was the first time I heard the band.
Kiss Alive 1.
And it was Kiss Alive 1.
Right.
There's some about Kiss for me that live seems to suit their style of music so much better to my ear.
Yeah, it's a good album. There's no doubt, man.
That you're going to hear a little bit of a live kind of flavor to my list here
right.
because I really do enjoy it.
Yeah.
The song, it's about the song. I get it.
Yep.
But I'm going to talk about performances because they are performances.
Yeah, for sure, man.
Number 9, Strutter.
Yeah.
From Alive 1. It's one of the few Stanley Simmons co-written tracks.
That's right.
So for all you Kiss geeks, you knew that. For all you that don't, this is a weird thing. They always just kind of wrote their stuff. Paul had his tunes. Gene has his
tunes.
Generally
speaking, that's true. Yeah.
General, right? You know, there was the odd little collaboration later, but
this
is one of the few. And everybody says she's looking good. And the lady knows it's understood. Strutter.
Yeah.
Oh, as a kid, impressionable.
Yeah.
Loving this big time. And just the hook of it, all the everything, great vocals, great hook. Ace hooky licks into that epic solo on the live.
It's a great song.
And I know
I like the studio version too. Like I like both.
I just, there's some energy to that band.
Absolutely.
And the speed picks up.
It's a little faster,
And it's stuck in my head.
Yep.
And
it's wicked.
Big, big, big Kiss anthem, for sure. Everybody says she's looking good. And the lady knows it's understood.
Okay, coming in at number 8. Coming off this album right here, which I love. Dressed to Kill, 1975.
Mm-hmm.
Another Paul Stanley track.
Okay.
But the intro is written by Ace Frehley. So the intro is Ace.
Right.
Paul and Ace play the intro, then it's Paul Stanley's song. Girl, you hit rock bottom and you're there to stay.
Ah.
I fucking love rock bottom. But I want the studio version on this one because that guitar intro is longer.
Right.
I don't think it adds anything live. I like the studio version. I fucking love that song. The intro, guitar intro, is half the song.
Yeah.
And then they cut in like, hit.
Yeah.
And they hit it. There's something about that song. It just makes me smile like you are right now.
Yeah.
I love it. And it's my number 8, rock bottom.
Paul's vocal on that song.
Oh, man.
This is gonna fit you good.
Oh,
you know, it's
man.
Just that little.
Yeah.
It's goosebumps.
He's such a great
immediately,
singer.
Immediately. Really suits him.
Yeah.
Paul writes well for Paul.
Yes, he does.
Sure, he does.
Yeah. What can I say? That's all I can say is I love it, man.
Yeah, great
choice.
You hit
rock bottom and you're there to stay.
Great choice.
Yeah.
Great choice.
Yeah. Hey, buddy, you're number eight.
I love the song as soon as you hit one fucking second. And then the groove sits in. And this is when you hear Ace sing, which is just so fucking great. Shock Me.
Yes.
Number eight. This song needs to be just fucking pinned when you hear it.
Yep.
Dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. Wow, wow. Oh, man. And then he sings. And we were waiting for this, you know. I wasn't waiting because I kind of came late to the party.
Sure.
But it was rare to hear him sing.
They wanted him to sing earlier, but he was too shy.
Sure, sure. Yeah. And he gave it, Gene sang some great Ace songs.
Yes, he did. We'll get to some of those later, perhaps.
Yeah, maybe. Potential. Potential for that. But I love it. I love it.
Yeah, it's a great song.
And it's kind of this well-crafted track. You know, it's...
It is.
The drums sound massive. Yep. The guitars sound massive. Vocals are great. Yeah, awesome.
Well, Ace, I find he's not a great singer, but his voice is just fucking cool. It's got a character to it I really like. Like, he's not Paul Stanley. He's never going to be that level of singer. Who cares? He sounds cool.
Yeah.
He just sounds badass.
Because of the story of the song, and if you don't know...
Oh, yes, right.
If you don't know the story of the song, he's touched some ungrounded fence or...
Well, it was a handrail on the stage.
Railing, railing.
He almost fucking died, dude.
Yeah.
Like, it was bad.
No, it was brutal. So you're going to remember that shit.
Yeah.
In Florida somewhere, like...
Yeah.
I don't know. And it was early, like it was 76.
I bet you somebody was fired. Ground that shit.
Yeah, no kidding. Like metal, man.
Almost lost our lead guitarist.
It's brutal, but...
That's right.
You know, so he writes this tune. You want him to sing that song.
Yeah. And he kind of, after that, came out of his shell, so to speak. And,
sure. And he turned it around to something cool. From something nasty and bad to something cool.
Right.
Is pretty great. And I really wanted, you know, I have to, on my top 10, I got to hear Ace singing. And this is... it's just too good. This track's too good.
Now you're killing me again. But yeah, and there's a reason. It hits his showcase live for his solo on that tour.
Yeah.
He does the big guitar solo and his guitar smokes and whatever.
All that jazz.
I'm going back to 1975's Dress to Kill again. Paul Stanley track, again. Love her all I can and try to understand the things that make her glad, the things that make her sad. Love her all I can.
Wow.
I fucking love that song. The groove. The swing, that drum breakdown. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Peter Criss is fucking drumming on that song. The cowbell, a lot of cowbell in Kiss stuff, but particularly on this song, it really shines.
Right.
And Peter Criss, up until, what album? He kicked ass right up till Alive 2. He was a great drummer. And it's cool he had that jazzy background because it swings like a traditional rock drummer maybe wouldn't swing.
Right.
Like, he brings something to the table that there's a reason this original four lineup sounds this way, and he is an integral part of that.
Oh.
Right?
The drums were never just there.
No.
The drums were never just there. I love her all I can and try and understand the things that make her plan, the things that make her say. I'm a lovely guy, I hardly ever cry. And when the world looks bad, she never ever say.
Love her all I can.
Oh, great choice, Randy.
Hey, man. Yeah. We're only overlapping on one song so far, which is awesome.
What do you want, seven?
Yes, seven, yeah.
Here's a song I just never tire of. It's in this pocket of groove that, again, you're going to hear groove a lot with Kiss.
No doubt.
And also arrangement, always about arrangement with this band because they just know how to break shit down, slow shit up. Firehouse.
Firehouse.
Oh, man. This is a live one. It just sounds so great live. And when he finishes singing it, he does this woo that I've never heard him do.
Yeah.
It's the only time he does it like that. And you know that that was a fucking fun moment for him, right?
Right.
Paul Stanley track. Blend of nothing but awesome is my note here.
Right.
From Into That Groove to the fucking sirens going off.
Yeah.
Gene blowing fire.
That's the fire song. Yeah.
It's all there. Solo, great. It's all there.
I love the song. For me, it's a little trudgy compared to some of the other ones I like more, but I like it. Of course I like it.
Get the fire out!
What are we at? Six. We're going to go to Hotter Than Hell for the first time.
Mm.
1974. Except the version I like is from 1975.
Okay.
Yeah. The Alive album.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. Song written by Gene. Little track called Living As You Do. I'm watching you.
Oh, yeah.
Watching you.
Right.
It is so, it's just evil sounding.
Oh, his vocal?
Watching us. When they do watching us instead.
I know.
Oh, I love it.
I know.
Oh, dude.
And he's got this way he sings. It's scary as fuck.
He's in character. He's in full-blown character.
Unbelievable.
Man. Yeah, really cool. Again, the lyrics are odd, which I like. Like some of his lyrics, well, I've heard him say he doesn't even know what they mean half the time. They just sound cool and... You know what I mean? It's not like an obvious lyric like Firehouse, you know, she sets my soul on fire. Like, that's a strange lyric in a cool way.
It's a great song, and... A song that really suited Kiss, you know?
Really suited Kiss and really suited him.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, totally. There's a lot of moments like that in here, but this one in particular, there's a couple.
But isn't that what is so cool about this band? One of the things is you got four guys, they all fucking sing, some more than others, of course.
Yeah, sure.
And that lends to the different characters. It's just more interesting.
And they're all
like
really
different.
Like, a Paul
song is going to be that. Yeah. A Gene song, Watching You, is going to be that.
Yeah.
He's going to be the demon. Yeah. He's going to be, you know, living as you do. He's going to be doing that.
I'm watching you.
Maybe that's where Hetfield got his delivery. But you know what I mean? Like, they're just an interesting band as opposed to have a one front man singing everything. It's just cool.
They were all responsible for all of it. Like,
oh, they all contributed. Yes.
Yeah.
For sure.
It was at the start.
Yeah.
Especially.
Yeah, the heyday is really what we're talking about.
And
here,
that's right. And that's all that's going to be on here. But
yeah, I like some other songs without makeup and stuff, but they're not on this level.
No. We're going back to Alive One again.
Yeah. How do you not?
Yeah. Probably because the way we started our show, I need to hear that. It's on this record.
Mm-hmm.
It's associated with one song, their starter, that just.
Yes, spit it out.
It's a nice little Gene song. Perfect. Really suits him too. Deuce.
Yeah.
You know.
Come on.
It just comes out of the gate hard, fast. No one understands what he's talking about. Again, showcases not only his singing and writing, but he makes sure he's got an element of his bass playing in there too. That huge bass slide into that.
You know what? He is an underrated bass player.
Shaking. Oh, we're going to talk more about that later.
He's a good bass player, man.
Yeah.
Very Beatle-esque.
Yeah, but, you know, and not afraid to get busy, you know? Like, he's not just staying in the pocket. Oh, I got an idea for this.
And
showcase his instrument, you know?
Totally.
Spitting blood, he doesn't need to. He can, although he does, and he's usually doing something with the bass, but...
I think it's because of all that other stuff. It overshadows that he is a really good bass player.
Right. But you listen, you hear it.
Yeah.
And it's so...
Totally, dude.
Great solos all the way through. And then that scream. Yeah! You know, I can't do it because I'll just wreck my throat.
Yeah.
But into that last section.
Yeah, it's
wow,
awesome.
Wow, man. That's That's heavy.
He's not worried about burning his voice out doing that. That's he's young. Heavy. Oh. He's young and giving her. Yeah, yeah, totally, dude. There's no way I'm going to argue with that. Okay, coming in at number five. Now we're into the top of the order, man. It's getting fucking crazy now.
Okay.
We're going, where are we going? We're going over here. Going
well, I like how you're doing this. I haven't, yeah, this That's is good. It's nice.
We're going Kiss Destroyer, 76.
Okay.
All right?
Yeah.
We're going with, and I command you to kneel before the God of Thunder and rock and roll. God of Thunder.
Right.
Number five. Written by Paul Stanley. Paul brings this song in,
yeah,
and it's like a shuffle. It's like
right, yeah, right,
and he's singing it,
right,
and he wants to sing it,
right.
Bob Ezrin's like, we're not going to do that,
right.
We're going to slow it down, and Gene's going to sing. And one thing about these guys, they want to service the song and do what's best for the song.
Right.
So Paul's like, fine, and it becomes a Gene Simmons song, and it's evil as fuck. It's got all those weird sound effects. It's got Bob Ezrin's kid saying crazy shit. Like as a kid, you hear that. And it just sounds bizarre. And lyrically too, I mean, as a kid, again, as a kid, you're focused on it. If it sounds cool, it's great. Not super focused on it, but you know, a line like, the spell you're under will slowly rob you of your virgin soul. I mean, that's fucking dark. And this came later. You hear that and go, ooh, that's dark, man. It's a heavy fucking track. And can you imagine
eight?
It faster and Paul singing? It would not have a fraction of the impact. It's so badass. And it's the song Gene spits blood in. It's a whole showcase. Yeah, it's wicked.
Yeah.
God of Thunder, number five.
God of Thunder and rock and roll. The spell you're under will slowly rob you of your virgin soul.
I cannot believe, still only one song we're going to overlap on, but I got a feeling. I don't know that yet.
I don't know, but
we haven't overlapped at all, man. This is awesome.
Well, we are going to overlap
Oh, we're going to overlap eventually.
Because I'm going to hit five here, and it's just a little higher on my list, and it's a Paul song. Yeah. And your notes and I are very, very similar.
Yeah, sure.
Perfect Paul song.
Fucking absolutely. Love Gun. I mean, come on.
That catchy melody and the showcasing his voice, how he sings.
Yeah.
It's just, it's all there.
It's perfect.
But the Beachy vocals are also big. Like these guys sang.
Yeah.
Like, and they weren't sitting there with an auto tune, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Kind of thing.
Man, you touch on that. Their vocal harmonies are awesome.
After they've spent some time in the studio, they know how to make things sound better, right?
Yes.
Because I think
Eddie Kramer,
Destroyer happened, you know, and they learned, this is what's going on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Eddie Kramer producing, and he produced Rock and Roll Over, Love Gun, and Alive, right?
Right. Yeah, because he was part of,
And he produced Zeppelin and Hendrix.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he knows what he's doing, man.
Yeah. But this is pop, like, it was a little poppier, like.
Sure.
And that guitar riff at the end. Fucking closing the door.
Oh, man.
So,
Ace just hits a home run with that solo.
Oh, that song I can hear till my grave without any hesitation. Just bing.
Live, it's Paul swinging across the audience to the second stage. It's just, it's everything about it is just wicked.
And again, so true to that character.
Yeah.
They really, really found their.
That's his song. That is the Paul Stanley song.
And it's his fave. It's he loves that song more than any other.
Coming in at number four. Off of this bad boy again, Hotter Than Hell, 1974. An Ace Frehley track.
Oh, I think I know which one that is.
Strange Ways, Twisted Days. Strange Ways. I fucking love this song. The riff is heavy as fuck.
Wow.
The guitar solo is probably my favorite Ace solo, even over Love Gun.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. It's so weird and cool.
Who produced that?
I think it's Kenny Kerner and Richie Kerner. Wise or whatever.
Yeah,
the
yeah.
production is
the
terrible.
The first couple, yeah, yeah.
But you know what? People dog the production, but maybe it's just with time. I wouldn't change it. Like, it kind of has a dark, dingy kind of vibe with the shitty production, if you want to call it that, that I kind of like now.
Yeah.
Anyway, what else can I add? Yeah, evil fucking riff. The solo's crazy good. And let me just start talking about this. We haven't touched on this. I love Peter Criss's voice.
Mm-hmm.
Love it. Little Rod Stewart, only with more balls.
Yeah.
Every song he sings, Black Diamond, fucking Getaway, I love his voice, and he kills it on this. And I saw them, they did, before the 96 reunion, they did a Bad Boys of Kiss tour, and they played a bar in town.
Okay.
Back alley.
So right.
It was the two of them.
Okay.
And they did Strange Ways.
Huh.
I was like, there it is.
Yeah.
I can leave now.
Wow.
You know, it was awesome. I love the song. That's why it's number four. Fucking huh. Strange Ways.
Oh, I'm all with you on Peter Criss singing.
Oh, killer.
Okay. So we're on four?
You're on four, buddy. Yep.
The fact that this song had sound design off the beginning... let's
just go right to that.
Let's just go right to this record.
Can I guess opening track?
It was kind of so awesome. And what you'd expect, because it was all theater of the mind with them anyways, from the live records you listened to as a kid to this.
Yeah.
It made perfectly good sense.
Absolutely did.
Oh my God. Number four, Detroit Rock fucking City. Yeah, okay, they got a guy that knows what he's doing in the studio to somehow make this band almost larger than life. Like, it was on a different level with this song. And what
we're talking
happened.
About Bob Ezrin.
We're talking about
Destroyer.
Right.
And Revenge way later. So,
right.
And The Elder.
So it was Kiss in a whole new way to me.
It was
a whole rebranding of Kiss.
Yep.
And not all of it worked for me, but this
right.
song, holy fuck.
Now, holy fuck indeed.
Yes. That start, all that sound design, I never yeah. tire of it. I'll listen
right.
to it. I couldn't care less if it's 2 minutes of my day. Paul sounds incredible. He's
oh my God.
Just so there.
Yeah.
And Gene, when he does get up, oh fuck! He's not holding like
so Gene,
so Paul on the radio. Whoa! Oh fuck! Goosebumps.
Yeah.
But here's back to the bass riffs.
Yeah. Oh yes. Doodly doo doo.
Right.
Yeah.
Here's a little moment where I can shine. You
yes.
know, and, oh.
And he just tucks it right in there, right?
Right.
There's nothing else going on.
And you never tire of it.
No.
It's like
you
air bass guitar player.
Yeah.
So there's not many songs that have an air bass guitar player.
That's right.
Right.
You want to slap it to bass.
Yeah. Do-do-do. Oh, yeah.
Oh, totally, dude.
There's a piano in the track. Like,
yep.
It's an orchestration to some degree. I don't know how much in this.
It's subtle, but it's there.
Yeah, but it's there.
Yep.
Now, I know the solo is scripted. It's not.
Oh, it's awesome, though.
But it's still fucking great.
Oh, yeah.
Ace didn't write the solo.
Mm.
He played the solo.
Mm-hmm.
But it was all crafted. This whole record was crafted.
Get up, everybody's gonna move their feet. Get down, everybody's gonna leave their seat.
even know if they like that experience that much, but thank God this song came out.
If you know about Bob Ezrin, he takes no shit. Like, it's his way or the fucking highway. And he busted their asses, especially Ace and Peter.
Right.
They became better players after that album because of that. He's a taskmaster.
Yeah.
In a good way. But a lot of people, when they changed their sound to Destroyer, did not, like, hardcore fans did not like the album. As a kid, I don't give a fuck. Oh, it's a new Kiss album. But the older fans were like, what the fuck is this? Yeah. Orchestration and piano? Yeah. I didn't give a fuck. It's all good.
Oh, when I heard that song,
come on.
So that's what I mean. Like, the record, it went in ways that didn't seem right, but this one made up for all of it.
Yeah.
Right?
Totally.
So when you hear it, so top five.
I mean, I could have lived without Great Expectations, for example.
Of course.
But good outweighs the bad by far on that album, though.
That's Gene.
Yes.
That's Gene turning into a bit too much Gene.
Yes.
Right?
I mean, that's the only stiff on the album. But anyway. Okay, number three, yeah?
Yeah.
Number three, going back to this one. Back to Hotter Than Hell.
Wow.
1974. Back to Ace Frehley, Parasite.
Okay.
Badass fucking riff. Badass song. What can I tell you? Sung by Gene. Right? Another wicked vocal by Gene.
Oh, yeah.
Evil as hell. And I love a good cover version. And Anthrax, who are huge Kiss fans, do an awesome version of Parasite on this EP, Attack of the Killer Bees.
Right.
But, of course, it sounds like Parasite, but it sounds like Anthrax. So the drumming is nothing like Peter Criss.
Right.
Like, it is unbelievable. Right. Charlie Benante is just a beast on this track. Look it up, or I'll post it. But, yeah, it's a wicked song, and that's why it's number three on my list.
I love Parasite. Maybe that's why it was probably really powerful, because the drums didn't get in the way, because that shredding kind of gained guitar, just so quick, so fast.
Yeah. It's heavy,
Gene's vocals.
Oh, man.
It scares you again. You know? Again, another song that Parasite, the name, just works so well with Kiss more than Christine 16 or something. You know what I mean? Or, you know?
It's just heavier, for sure.
Way heavy, way heavy track.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a beauty.
I had to give
a
boy Ace some fucking props.
It's a beauty.
Well, Strange Ways and Parasite back to back.
He's got a few tracks in the top 10.
Yes.
And they're all been different, which is fucking crazy.
Good point.
We're at three?
You're at three, buddy.
Going back to a live one.
Yeah.
We're going back 100,000 years to a live one.
Speaking of bass, great bass on that.
It's so catchy. It's a Gene song.
Yep.
Must have been a bitch when I was gone.
And again, the lyrics are obscure and cool. They're not obvious.
There's not much for lyrics here.
Right. That's what I mean.
That's a repetitive lyric, verse, chorus, three times almost.
Yeah.
Like,
they've got a few songs like that, actually.
Like, there's nothing going on there.
Right.
But the song and the melody and hearing it live as a kid, that one just resonated and I couldn't shake it. That was unbelievable.
That's the one that's got the extended Paul Stanley sing-along thing, right?
Well, you got it.
You
got the drum solo.
Yeah, right.
Which is all the...
That's a great drum solo, by the way.
That phasing and stuff, as a kid, you're hearing that going, wow, these guys are just nothing like I've ever heard before on every level.
Peter Criss kills it on that solo.
Oh, and the guitar solo is so killer on 100,000. Yep. Yep. Everything is killer.
Yeah.
That's why it's in the top three.
Oh, killer,
this
no
song,
filler.
This, the breakdown in this song.
Yeah.
When they just, and Lee Paul out there,
yep.
just getting the, oh, fuck. When I was going, oh, you know,
yeah,
it just,
yeah.
oh. And I love the train wreck style end. Like they didn't,
yep.
you know, it was a little, it was so good that they wanted to make it just a little messier. And
right.
somehow it, the way I hear it, right? Yep.
No doubt, man.
And a live version, you got to. You
yeah.
have to.
I like the studio version too, but there's a different dynamic for sure.
Sure. And yeah. you get to hear with this top
yep.
10 playlist,
yeah.
you get to hear some Paul interacting with the crowd, which
sure.
is really fun, you know?
It is, but if I could just be devil's advocate
yeah.
with some of the live stuff, I don't necessarily want to hear the fucking drum solo every time I hear 100,000 years. That's why I go to the studio a lot.
I
don't
it.
Need the 10-minute fucking...
I get
That's
it, but
I'm
just saying the way I want to hear this song.
Absolutely.
Yeah. yeah. Not every day. you
That's
know
right.
what I mean?
Yeah.
In a loop.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
know? But
yeah.
when I hear it, I'm going, yeah, I can listen to Paul. Yeah.
Right.
Get the crowd going and everybody's loving this and how fast it is
totally.
Compared to the record. Awesome.
It's like God of Thunder on Alive 2. Well, I'm not going to listen to it because I don't want to listen to Peter Criss's drum solo again.
Right. But That's it's all. A good one.
And
yeah.
that, well, Alive is better because
yeah.
Alive 2 not as good, but.
Oh, yeah.
Well,
yeah.
good choice, man.
Yeah.
I love that line. Must have been a bitch while I was gone.
Yeah.
I fucking love it.
yeah. I own you.
Oh, like, dude. just great.
Gene. and just able to write one that Paul sounds fucking great on. It's
and again,
awesome.
That's debut album stuff.
There's a lot of them on my list.
And they're young.
Sure.
Like
yeah.
pretty seasoned songwriters going on there on that first album.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not rocket science,
yeah.
but it's catchy and cool.
Yeah.
And that's all you need, right?
Yeah.
Okay, man, number two.
You're at two?
I'm at two, buddy.
Oh, my God.
Where are we going? We're going here.
Okay.
1976, Destroyer, song written by Paul Stanley and Bob Ezrin. Opening
yeah.
track,
yeah.
Detroit,
yeah.
fucking rock, fucking city.
See,
yeah. I mean, come on.
I know.
I just remember as a kid dropping the needle on that first song. I'm like, what am I listening to?
Yeah.
It was very cool.
Oh.
And then ga-dun, and it blended in with the actual
oh,
track.
Oh, yeah.
And you're off. You're off on this fucking journey, man. And I love everything about that song.
Me too. And I never
Fuck.
Tire of it.
You know what's crazy? Is that was the single. So they send it out to all the radio stations. Beth's on the other side thinking, they think it's a throwaway
right,
song.
Right,
Well, DJ started flipping it over for whatever reason.
Right. See what else is on there.
Buried Detroit Rock City. Beth goes through the roof. Weird.
Yeah.
What else can I say? Oh, yeah. So I'm a young man around that time. So that's 76. No YouTube then, obviously. No fucking VCRs. None of that shit. So if you want to see something on TV, you got to sit there, park your ass in front of the TV and see it. You're going to see it once.
Right.
That's when I saw this. The Paul
Oh,
Lynn
yeah, the Paul Lynn. Yeah,
Halloween
yeah.
special.
yeah.
They did Detroit. They did King of the Nighttime World and Beth.
Right.
But Detroit Rock City. Holy fuck. It just blew my mind. Kiss is moving. I hadn't seen them move. It was all photos before
right,
that.
Right, right.
It was, it's hard to describe to somebody young how crazy, that must sound just stupid, but it was just mind blowing to see that.
Yeah.
And they're just going for it. It was a condensed version of the song for TV
sure.
and their lip sync and who cares.
Sure, sure.
And they're blowing up the amps and Gene
yeah.
is doing those squat jumps.
Yeah.
And
oh, yeah.
I mean, it was just insane. Get on, I remember my
yeah.
mom going, are you going to be okay? Because like, I'm just fucking shaking watching this.
Yeah,
thing,
yeah,
right?
yeah. Oh, yeah.
Anyway, that was just, and then Kiss Me's the Phantom comes out and, you know, they're starting to, they get on TV more. But that was the first time I saw them on television. And it was just, it was life-changing, man. Just unbelievable.
Fuck, so you got the DVD.
That was way later.
It's crazy to think, too, that they started their tour in Edmonton.
That's right.
This tour.
Oh, they went to Canada first.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Edmonton first.
Edmonton and then Calgary, they played Sate.
Yeah. They did Lethbridge.
What?
Yeah.
Well, they did Lethbridge on the fucking Love Gun tour. Like they toured. You didn't have to be in a huge fucking city. They would show up and scale.
Oh, but
I'm
talking 74.
Oh, I know.
Yeah,
I realize
like,
that. But even when they're big, they would
yeah.
tour these smaller towns and scale the stage down a bit. Like
yeah.
they were not lazy. They fucking
no.
worked.
No. And yeah.
Think of this. This blows my mind all the time. This is 74, this first album.
Yeah.
This is 77. the peak of their powers, alive too. Do the math. That's 3 years go by.
Yeah.
Metallica takes 10 years to do one album.
Yeah.
Like, it's crazy how short a period of time we are actually looking at on these albums. And two albums in 1 year.
But also groundbreaking in the sense that this kind of defined what a live record now needs to
be. Well, if that didn't take off, we wouldn't be talking about Kiss.
Yes, right.
The record company, they were going to bury
it. But that's what was so important about this band.
Yeah.
Was that they knew it.
Yeah.
They knew it.
Okay,
crazy.
Buddy.
What am I, number two?
Number two, Part Dieu.
Part Dieu. This is a Stanley song in my number two. The intro moved me as a small child. Kind of a lullaby type quality. So sweet the way Paul
was singing. Oh, I know what it is.
So sweet the way he sang to me.
Is it on this one,
Paul? Oh, it is. It's he sang to me in the...
Yes.
They're putting me off to sleep.
Oh, it's just such a great song. Yeah.
Then all hell breaks loose with the hit.
Now hit it.
And to your comment, fuck that he sang great
on this song.
Like, just awesome.
Peter Criss.
Oh, every bit of Kiss song.
Are you going to tell our listeners what it is?
Black Diamond.
Again, what's Black Diamond mean? Don't care.
Don't care.
Sounds cool. I heard it was a nickname for a hooker, is one thing I read.
Oh, is that right?
I don't know if that's true.
Yeah.
But go ahead.
Interesting. This just hits on all levels. Pure Kiss track, the double guitar switch off that defines all their classics.
Yep.
They have a way of working together. This song is just unbelievable. That, boom, bam, dum, dum, boom, boom. You know, it's just
not only the
so weird.
The guitar switch over, Beau, they're one of the few bands where different vocalists on the same song a lot.
Right.
Which is very
one
cool.
One starts, something does the next, and you couldn't, you're not feeling, one's better.
No.
It's just all what the song needs.
You goosed me up, man.
Peter, you sang this one. Okay. Yeah.
No problem.
Sure. It just happens to be the second favorite Kiss song I know. That groove, the guitar solo, holy fuck.
Yeah.
This is the live version.
Right.
So again, go in there. And that end, well, on the record, I love the way it slows down.
See, if I could nitpick, because I've listened to it so many times, right?
Yeah.
I find it annoying now. Like, I just want it, I don't want to listen to the slowed down. I just want it to end now.
Right.
So I don't have to skip it.
But at the time, it's so cool
but
as
I'm
a kid going, what?
Yeah.
And you're scared. You're like, that's scary.
Right.
Somehow. I mean, in the live version, they don't slow it
that's
down.
Right.
They just bang. But you know, there's explosions going off.
Yeah.
So as a kid or me are going, holy fuck, there's a ton of energy on that stage right now. And it's all over it. So creepy and so Kiss-like.
It's
that end.
Awesome.
I love the song. I love hearing them sing.
Yeah. And I love too live the choreography on it, where it's Gene and Ace drops to his knees and Paul's doing it. I mean, they still do it today. That stuff is just cool as hell live. Like the way they choreograph that, you know, it's just really badass. And then the drum kit goes up.
Yeah.
That's that song, man. Fuck, I can't believe it's not on my list. Jesus Christ.
It's not.
Again, it's just too many.
And I don't think ones are the same, but maybe they are.
No, they're not. Because you already mentioned mine.
I did.
You wanted the best? You
got it.
The hottest band in the land?
Wow.
Kiss. Deuce is my number one. Deuce is my favorite Kiss song. Bar none. Studio, live.
Right.
It's my favorite Kiss song.
Wow.
If I had only listened to one Kiss song for the rest of my life, it would be Deuce.
Wow.
Yeah. Great riff. It fucking rocks. You can hear all the pyro, like you said. Fake or not, it puts you there in your mind.
Yeah.
Incredible.
Yeah.
This guitar solo is just badass. And I love when Paul goes, do it.
Yes.
I mean, every time.
Yeah.
And, and Gene's scream, like you said. Oh, and the choreography again. When they do that breakdown.
Yeah.
They do that guitar thing.
Yeah.
It's just cool as hell.
Yeah.
Sean Delaney, I guess, did that. He was like the fifth member of the band. Again, the lyrics. Get up and get your grandma out of here. What the fuck does that mean? Gene doesn't even know what that means.
No.
Who's his grandma we're talking about? Yeah, why are they so mean to her?
Get up and get your grandma out of here.
According to Gene, the riff is Bitch Backwards by the Rolling Stones. That's all he did. They do a lot of that, by the way. They take a Who song and flip the riff and come up with something.
Oh, my God.
But everybody steals from everybody. And Deuce was the first song this guy, Ace Frehley, ever played with Kiss.
Right.
Deuce, number one. I'm out.
That's a pretty great list. I'm going to have to get that playlist. Well, I'm going to end with a...
Hang on a second. Just give me a moment to think if I can guess, because you have me just curious as fuck. Okay, I want two cracks at it. She or Got to Choose?
Neither.
Shit. What is it, for fuck's sake?
It's an Ace song.
You're killing me. Oh, it's an Ace song. Rocket Ride, Getaway.
Cold Gin.
Oh, fuck. Oh.
Dun, dun, dun. Oh, man.
It's Cold Gin time again.
Yeah.
Duh.
As a kid.
Yes.
Doing the. This is great that you didn't know. That's how catalog is.
Yeah.
Funny you brought up She, but Cold Gin.
Forgot about Cold Gin.
As a kid, when you saw his name behind it, looking at that record.
Yeah.
I wanted to be Ace Frehley.
Come on.
That's it.
Yeah.
That was it. So that one song was played more than any other song on that record for that whole reason.
Right.
Period.
Right. Some good riffs in that one.
Oh, sure. But Paul coming in with the, all right, you know? Whoa. Oh,
right. You get that on the live version. You don't get that on the studio. That's right. That's
like
right.
This live, live one. Yeah. Gene singing, like the way he worked, this is just so.
And it's cool that he takes somebody else's lyric and sings it with that kind of conviction. It's just fucking awesome.
Yeah. When he hits that intro, it puts you right there. Hello, Mr. Frehley.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of moment.
Yeah.
Who's my hero? Flicking that tone switch back and forth.
Yeah.
Right. Going into the groove. Now, the bass licks. We're going back to Gene again.
Let's give more props to Gene.
Gene on the bass.
Sure.
Because if you listen to this song and just isolate the bass in your brain, just kind of start to just pay attention to those frequencies, you will not be disappointed.
Yeah, it's good.
On the live version, it is killer. I mean, I know might have been overdubbed. It doesn't matter. He's doing it, right?
Doesn't matter. Yeah.
Then comes the sweet ass breakdown.
Yes.
Oh, fuck. Da, 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 da. Oh.
It's so simple, but it's cool.
Great song, and I just I can't.
It's a great song. It's just number one. For me, so that's a little lofty, but it's good for sure. It's good.
Just this is my experience, and I just can't get it out of my head. You know,
better than Deuce. Come on, better than Detroit Rock City. You're nuts.
Cold Gin, not better than Detroit.
Come on. Oh, that was awesome, man. Okay, now this. I love. So usually we do the three honorable mentions.
Right.
Your idea was, fuck that. Let's pick one song and one song only off each 78 solo album. I'm like, oh, this is a great idea.
Yeah.
Now we can talk about those albums. So let's do that.
Yeah. And we should talk about those albums because at the time we were very excited as a Kiss fan that there was going to be four records.
No doubt.
With all new material.
What are they going to sound like?
Oh, and they all had their persona in the band. Like, it was clear from the beginning. And you're very excited. You dialed one way or another, you know, generally.
Yeah.
Most people gravitated to Ace, and I understand. But it's...
But you're right. At the time, it's a different perspective than now. More so than the other albums, I think.
Sure.
Because, man, you wanted them. Like, they shipped a million each. They were a little...
They were zealous.
Overzealous.
Yeah, yeah.
They were in the bargain bin shortly thereafter. Sure. But they shipped platinum, all four of them, right?
But they looked great. Like when you saw them, you wanted them. You had to have them.
And as a kid, you don't realize, well, they're about to break up. This was like to prevent a breakup. These guys had a harder time getting on the albums, Ace and Peter. That's just how it was.
Right.
They just did.
Yeah.
So this was a way of, okay, let's each do an album under the Kiss banner and off we fucking go. And I like them all. To varying degrees.
Do you?
I do. Varying degrees, obviously, right. But I do like them all, yeah.
Yeah, because see, it reminded me, this whole process reminded me how it just, they're not great. I mean, Ace is the exception because there's, you know, just more material on his record for me to, well, to get my-
Paul's pretty fucking good, too.
Paul's, it depends on what you're into at the time. And I like Paul with Kiss.
Well, I think his is the most Kiss-sounding album. That's my personal opinion.
Yeah.
Maybe that's because Ace didn't get that many songs on Kiss albums, but his is
potential,
the most Kiss.
Potential, yeah.
If you really think about
it. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Let's do this.
Okay, let's go. Yeah, let's go. I like talking about it, though.
Yeah, we're going to do that.
Okay.
Okay. So I'll go first if we're going to keep it going that way.
Sure.
Well, let's go in the order we have them on the table here. I'll start with Peter Criss.
Okay. Going with Peter. All right.
Okay, here's my thoughts on the Peter Criss solo album. So... Vinny Poncia produced it, and he also produced Dynasty, that bad boy right there.
Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Guest stars include Steve Lukather.
Yep.
From Toto. He's on That's the Kind of Sugar Papa Likes, and he's on Hooked on Rock and Roll. I think if you pull back and forget that this is under the Kiss banner, it's good. But it's hard to forget that. Like, people were all fucking, what is this?
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is the stuff he's into. It's just not Kiss. So if you just kind of pull back from that, there's some good stuff on it. That's my opinion. I love his voice, so that sells a lot of it for
me. Right,
right. As far as the track, I like That's the Kind of Sugar Papa Likes. There's something about that song I like, but I didn't go with that one. I went with the big ballad at the end, I Can't Stop the Rain, with the orchestration. I think that's a really moving, epic fucking ballad, and that's the one I went with. And he didn't write it, Sean Delaney.
Right.
The fifth member of Kiss, a lot of people say he wrote it. But that's my pick. And I think it gets overly hammered on because it doesn't sound like Kiss. So what? If you back it up and just listen to it as a pop album, there's some really good stuff on it. That's my speech.
I can't stop the rain. Here it comes again. Lightning strikes across the sky.
I agree that he had his heart set in a different genre of music. Like he kind of, that was
his
comfort level, and that's what he wanted to do. And to his credit, he just did it. You know, he didn't.
That's a good angle.
Right.
He just fucking did it.
Yeah. Like I wasn't expecting, well, I don't think he was expecting Beth.
Right.
And then all of a sudden having this huge thing to fucking prove. Right. Because he's got all this heavy on him now as like the number one single from Kiss and it's your song, you know?
That's a good point. There's some pressure there.
Right? That's not this record, not even close.
No, and he did like Hooligan off Love Gun. It rocks. And Baby Driver off Rock and Roll Over is awesome.
Yeah.
I love that song.
Yeah.
I just wish there was a little more Baby Driver on that.
Sure.
But.
Sure.
Yeah.
I didn't mind listening to the record. It's not my thing. You know?
Right.
I like his voice in Kiss.
Right. I'm just so hardcore.
Somehow I just, because it has such a role for me. Black Diamond is specifically, right? So, but yeah.
If you had to pick one, Beau, what was it?
Yeah, I picked That's the Kind of Sugar Papa Likes, because.
It's a cool little song. Right?
Well, I mean, it was a fun little track.
Yeah. So when they did the Dynasty tour, each guy picked a song to play at the show.
Oh.
So his was Tossing and Turning.
The cover. Yeah.
The cover. Yeah. Yeah. So yeah. And ironically, his sold the worst, and he released two singles off it where everybody else just released one.
Right.
So that's kind of ironic. And if I could backtrack, so my brother Blair and I were at this point just deep into Kiss.
Yeah.
Like we shared a bedroom, all four walls, ceiling, Kiss pictures.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everybody wants this one.
Right.
Everybody wants the Gene solo album. So I'm like, so we have, you know, we're sharing a room. We're not each going to buy all four albums. It's stupid.
Right.
So we're going to get two apiece.
Right.
So we're like, how are we going to do this?
Yeah.
Who gets Gene?
Yeah.
So long story longer. Okay. If you get Gene, then you have to take Peter's. Like you kind of knew.
Right. Yeah.
So yeah. I fucking destroyed him. Blair got Gene and Peter. I got Paul and Ace.
Wow.
I won that one.
Yeah. You want... Yeah, anybody that got Ace won the deal, in my opinion.
I like Paul's a lot, too, but yes. The short answer is yes. Okay, let's go to Gene.
Okay.
So...
I already know what
this is. It's produced by Gene and Sean Delaney, that guy I keep mentioning.
Right.
He's co-written five Kiss tracks altogether. Guest stars include Joe Perry, Bob Seger, Rick Nielsen, Helen Reddy. Remember her?
Oh, yeah.
I Am a Woman. Yeah. Hear me roar.
Roaring.
Jeff Skunk Baxter, Donna Summer, and Cher does a little cameo. So... He's full Hollywood here.
Right.
He's entrenched in that world. And I mean, okay, this is a good little experiment I'm going to have.
Right.
Here's what's going to happen. Okay. I picked When You Wish Upon a Star. No, I'm kidding.
You didn't. I was just going to say.
I mean, you can make fun of Peter all you want. He didn't sing that.
Yeah.
I almost went with See You Tonight. It's kind of a Beatles-y song.
Yeah.
You talk about lyrics. It's the same three lines over and over and over and over.
Yeah.
But there's something about it that's kind of catchy. I didn't go with that one. I had to go with Burning Up with Fever.
Huh.
I like there's a heavy riff in the verse, and then there's a bit of a poppy Donna Summer background vocal kind of chorus on it.
Right.
That's the one I went with. There are other tracks on it I do enjoy, but I mean, as a kid, I expected it to be way heavier. You can have me just a one time, baby. What you say? Maybe I'll give you a chance. 'Cause I'm burning up with fever. And you're the fever inside. Gene's puzzled me more.
Right.
Because if you look at the Gene songs, they're not on here.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing heavy on there, really.
Well, like you said, it was Hollywood. It seemed like he got into this kind of party atmosphere, right? Which the music
But where's Watching You and fucking some of these heavy songs, right?
Yeah.
So his tour song was Radioactive.
I know.
That was his single. And here's my last point on that. He redid See You in Your Dreams from Rock and Roll Over. Why?
Yeah.
It sounds better on Rock and Roll Over. Why are you redoing it?
Right. He wanted to fill some time on the record.
I don't know. So it's spotty.
Yeah.
To say the least. Okay, buddy.
Living in Sin.
At the Holiday Inn. The Cher track. That's the Cher one.
It doesn't matter to me. Yeah. It was.
Is this Gene Simmons?
Yeah.
But I hated the reason I like that one until he goes, or whatever he's doing there. It's awful.
I was trying to just salvage something off this record.
I was trying to salvage something.
Because it didn't, not much work for me on this record.
Right.
I have a different vision of Gene. And
absolutely.
It's so hard to shake it, right?
I mean, it's Gene fucking Simmons. I remember trying to like it so hard and didn't quite get there. Like, I don't hate it by any means. I like some of the songs, but I don't love any of it.
Yeah.
You just wanted something else.
Your great expectations.
That could have been, just you should have put it on there.
That's right, exactly. That would have been actually a great track. God.
Oh, Gene.
Oh, my God.
Okay.
All right.
Let's go to Mr. Stanley. Paul Stanley. So it's produced by him and this guy named Jeff Glicksman, who produced some Kansas stuff. Guest stars include Bob Kulick, who's come up on the show before.
Yeah.
And he played on a bunch of Kiss stuff, especially the studio tracks on Alive 2. I dig this whole album. I really do, a lot, except for one track, that Hold Me, Touch Me. I can't. Even for him, it's too...
I can't.
But every other song, I like a lot.
He had to find the level, the limit.
Oh, and that was
He took it to the limit.
I think he crossed it.
He crossed it.
Baby, won't you touch me? Oh, it's terrible. But every other song I like a lot, actually. Mm-hmm. But I had to go with the opening track, Tonight You Belong to Me. It's fucking awesome.
Is that right?
Yeah. It's got that slow ballad intro, and which he kind of does a lot of that.
Yeah.
And then he hammers it. It's awesome. He sings his ass off on the whole album, actually. And Bob Kulick's solo on that song is fucking cool as hell, too.
Right.
So I went with the opening track, Tonight You Belong to Me. But I could have went Love in Chains. I could have went fucking Wouldn't You Like to Know Me. I like all those songs.
Yeah.
But Tonight You Belong to Me, I think, for me, is the strongest one.
Well, I went with Wouldn't You Like to Know Me.
Yeah, it's a great song.
I'm a sucker for that pop stuff.
Totally.
And it sounds great.
No pushback here, man.
You hear a lot of bands that got into that kind of anthemic rock. She was kind of cutting some new lines there, too.
Here's what's crazy though. His single was the one I hate, Hold Me, Touch You. That's the single.
I know.
What are you thinking?
Yeah.
And the tour song, he didn't move on live. That's the one he did.
Which one?
Move On.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Upbeat.
Yeah.
Well, that, wouldn't you like Nomi's upbeat too? But.
Well, yeah. And I thought it just has just a hookier kind of arrangement.
I like it too, man.
I liked it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's save the best for last.
Yeah.
Mr. Freely.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah.
Produced by Eddie Kramer, which is smart because he produced.
Yeah.
A bunch of great Kiss stuff. Okay, guest stars include Anton Figg on drums and Will Lee on bass from Letterman's Band. So there's your solid fucking rhythm section.
Right.
Right.
And Anton's been doing stuff when Peter got...
That's right. He's on Dynasty.
He's on all that. Yeah.
And he's on Ace Frehley's Comet.
Yeah.
I love Rip It Out, like that opening song. Again, there's a cool, I'm not done yet.
Okay.
There's that cool drum thing.
Yeah.
Anton just fucking kills it on that fucking track. And I almost went Fractured Mirror, but I thought that's an instrumental, as great as it is.
I know, and it was cool that it ended that way. But
my excuse is it's an instrumental.
Yeah.
I'm looking for reasons to cut shit out.
Hey, man, me too. Everything in that
I love that. John 5 does a cool version of that too, by the way. It's pretty note for note, but it's cool. But.
As he would do.
I had to go with Snowblind.
Okay.
That fucking riff is so awesome. The solo is awesome. I love the way it slows down at the end. Snowblind is my favorite song of that album, for sure. Rip It Out is right there, but Snowblind is my pick. Gio, what's that about, you think? Is he doing coke at that time? What do you think?
Yeah. I love New York Groove.
I don't.
You don't?
No.
See, I like it. I mean, it's not his song.
I don't get why it's so big. I honestly don't.
It had this vibe to me that he was kind of this partying Ace Frehley dude that, you know, it just...
Lyrically, I get it, but I think it's kind of boring.
It just had this fun frivolity, but I didn't pick it.
Good.
Yeah.
Because I'm back.
And I didn't...
Gah,
and
I'm
I didn't,
back in the New York.
Gah, I know, but it was just like... him.
I find
know.
It a bit dull. That's all I'm saying.
Sure. And Rip It Out was a bit... Was not quite... It was a great song.
Yeah.
But it didn't beat Snowblind because...
You picked Snowblind too?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. 'Cause I'm snowblind.
no one's doing Snowblind except Ace Frehley.
That's a really good point, because it's heavy.
It
he
is.
He writes the heaviest songs. You can say what you want. Parasite,
yeah, right on.
Cold Gin. These are heavy tracks. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that album's full of them. I like Speedin' Back, a little poppier, but I like the whole album. Yeah, Ozone.
There's not a whole lot missing
fucking
there.
Foo Fighters covered Ozone.
Did they really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that. You should look into that.
Okay. Yeah, totally.
Like, did it live?
No, studio. EP, like a little EP.
Oh, okay. Thing. That's why I'm not familiar. Yeah. Like, I'm going, when did they
That's
do
That's a deep track, too.
Interesting.
But yeah, Snowblind, awesome, right?
Yeah.
And New York Groove was obviously the one he did live. Gene likes to push back, but yeah, his sold the most, obviously.
Ace is dead.
Yeah.
Why? Gene thinks his does?
I've heard him say, oh, it's not by that much and all this stuff. I'm like, give me a break. Yeah, come on, Gene. Let's get real.
Yeah, he was a star. He was mine. 100%.
Yeah, well, how many guitar players picked up the guitar because of him?
Seeing that.
Most metal guitar players that I've heard interviewed, all of them. Ace really, man. That's why they picked up the guitar.
Seeing him, three humbuckers. Not that I knew what a humbucker was. It just looked different.
Yeah.
It's like this guy goes to 11.
Yeah.
This guy had the guitar that went to 11.
Right.
In my mind. Well, what the fuck is that? Yeah. Oh, yeah. And he looks like that? Yeah.
And he's the cool one. Let's face it, man.
Yeah.
He's the cool guy in the band.
Totally.
Like, I just don't... You take away the makeup, take away the show, all that stuff. If you like just groovy, catchy rock songs, I don't understand how you could dismiss Kiss's early catalog. Like, I just don't... Because people do, right? They get hung up on... the shtick. Well, when you buy their music, that's what you're buying. You're not buying a concert. You're listening to it.
Yeah.
The music is good. Are they Led Zeppelin? No. But I like them just as much. They're just different.
Oh, it's completely different.
Oh, Zeppelin and Kiss. Why don't you talk about the difference between apples and fucking oranges? Because that's what it is.
But this captured my attention way more than Zeppelin did.
Well, sure.
You know?
The image was going to do that.
Sure. They got that, but musically they backed it up, as you hear.
Yeah.
And
just because it's not virtuoso stuff, whatever that means, who cares? It makes you feel good. Music is entertaining. It's how do you feel when you listen to it?
Right. Like, yeah, if I want to get deep or something, I'll go to some style of music.
Right.
Could even be Zeppelin when I want to get deep because they got that kind of, this is not about deep. Really?
Yeah, but there's nothing deep about squeeze my lemon till the juice runs down my leg either.
No.
You know what
no,
I mean?
No, but just, sonically, they're a bit more intricate. But this is like, we're going to yell and scream, have a fucking great fucking time.
Right.
Like, when they are exhausted after playing their tunes, you know, it wasn't just to perform.
Well,
it was like, I'm going to fucking run around like a fucking madman. All of us are going to be
Well, that's why cooking. Alive isn't alive.
Right.
Because they make, when you're jumping around like that, you can't play perfect.
The drums are pretty much the only thing that's
right
from that.
That makes sense.
I think there's quite a bit more overdubbing than, even though they've said there's quite a bit. I think.
Oh, there's a ton.
And if you say, when you hear that, you know it's even more than that. Like, it's a lot.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter.
No.
Because this is the way I like to appreciate Kiss.
Right.
Is when I hear them performing.
Right.
They are performers.
Right.
First and foremost. Through and through.
I just don't get the need to compare. Like, why can't you just like everything? Like,
you
like them both. Like, you can't. Why do you got to compare everything?
You shouldn't.
It's not even close. Why compare them to Zeppelin? What for?
Who?
Enjoy both of them.
But who does that?
Well, in the 70s, who's better? Kiss sucks. Zeppelin's great. Like, that. It was those two bands.
It happened in the 80s, too.
In every schoolyard. Who cares? Why can't you like fucking Rat and Pink Floyd?
Sure.
Like, who gives a shit?
Or thrash metal and LA metal. There's the friction there.
Oh, we'll get
there. I know, and that's why I'm just going to segue into this on a future upcoming podcast, but we'll talk about
that. Our next podcast is that thrash doc. Yeah, we're going to talk about that. And I was going to say that exact thing. Why is this division? I don't get it.
Yeah.
I don't want to go down that rabbit hole necessarily. But,
no, but I know why you don't, because you're a music fan. You're not a music genre fan.
No.
You are a music fan.
Right.
Right?
As most of these guys, musicians are. I don't know if people know that. You think fucking Metallica just listens to fucking thrash metal? No. James Hetfield listens to Waylon Jennings and fucking whatever, because they're into music.
Sure. I think a lot of it has to do with age. And
sure.
You can look at it at a time when you're very influential, that when Kiss was happening for me, Rex Smith was happening for my cousin or something like that, right? Okay.
Right.
Not that they're comparable, but it's like everybody's got an opinion that's divisive. They love that. I love Kiss. Just because you're in a rock category doesn't mean you're going to like it.
But I'm talking about rock fans picking on other rock fans.
Right.
Like Kiss was super divisive, especially when you got into this period here. Like Dynasty, and like Kiss was like, if you said you like Kiss or wore a Kiss t-shirt, you could get fucking beat up in school.
Yeah.
This kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, it just seems insane, right? Because I felt a bit of that, just a tinge of it. I remember buying Dynasty, actually, and I lived in New Okanagan, and we went to the mall in Penticton. I bought Dynasty, went over to my cousin's place, and they were older. So she had friends over,
right,
who were into this Kiss, like early Kiss.
Yeah.
Well, Dynasty, they're done, and they're fucking, you know, but I'm way younger than them, and they're making fun of me.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
Oh, Kiss is over, man. They fucking suck, and they're older than me, and I want to be cool. And I'm like, oh, fuck, what have I done, you know?
No.
Fuck that.
I was still in there even though I was getting a little flack, but I'm a little younger yet.
Younger, yeah.
So
yeah,
no one's even giving me that much
that
flack.
Yeah, you kind of, right? Yeah, yeah.
But Kiss was an exception to the rule.
Right.
They were so different and so big and so everywhere. Like, what are they, 100 million records sold?
But I mean, that became part of the problem, right? Dynasty, the little kids are going to the show, and then it's not cool anymore, and it's like a fucking circus and Vegas-y and all that.
Right,
bullshit.
But I think people wanted a chance, and like, again, those numbers are staggering, man.
Oh, yeah.
Like 100 million records.
Hey, they're having the last laugh, man. They're still going.
30 gold records.
Like, the most of any artist in the States, I believe that's still.
I think that's still the case.
Yeah.
It's just a different second beast.
And worldwide, second only to the Beatles, I believe. Gene keeps saying that. That's why I know.
Oh, fuck.
In gold albums, second only to the Beatles. Gene. I mean, you don't, like Paul Stanley keeps saying, you don't buy a stage show. You do when you buy the ticket to the concert.
Yeah.
But you're not selling that kind of fucking volume of albums based on pyro.
Yeah.
There's no fucking way you are.
Yeah.
So have we defended Kiss enough?
I think we did.
I fucking love the band.
Me too.
Like, I don't have any 80s Kiss on CD, but I bought every cassette. They just didn't make the cut to the rebuy. You know, when you got to rebuy shit.
Right, right.
I'm like, yeah, I tried. I'm not buying the CD. I've got a mix of 80s Kiss, and it's about, I don't know, 15, 20 songs that I like. Mm. And they're good songs. But again, you just can't top this classic stuff in my mind, right? Especially in a top 10 or a top 20 for that matter.
No, and I just have a vision of Kiss that just will not be anything but...
But a good song's a good song, and they have written good songs after that.
Sure.
But I'm surprised how different our lists were in a good way, man, because it makes it more interesting, right?
Yeah. But it just also shows how different we are.
Yeah.
You know, like...
Or
that there is differences, you know what I mean? I mean, you could probably go and ask 10 other Kiss guys what their top 10
that's
is.
Right.
They're not going to be the same.
Well, I keep saying this, and I just don't know, I sound like a broken record. It's like comedy. You can't force a laugh. So Love Her All I Can makes me do this.
Yeah.
It might not do that to you.
Yeah.
There's no right or wrong.
See, that's my, I stole your love. I'm just.
Oh, dude, that was fucking, I'm like crossing it off. I'm like, what? How am I doing this?
Yeah.
But and it's not like I don't like those songs. I love those songs.
Mm-hmm.
But what moves you the most is a very subjective thing, right?
Right.
All right, buddy. That was awesome.
Okay, I'm done. I'm finished there.
We'll definitely do another one.
Do you want to talk about this before we go?
Oh, yeah. Let's talk about this. So a little shout out to my sister-in-law, Melissa. This is an actual broken Paul Stanley guitar. So this is my guess is at the end of the original four reunion. So I'm thinking Farewell 2000. And, this is before they started selling everything. Here's Paul Stanley's microphone. Here's his stage play guitar. Paul Stanley would smash his guitar in half at the end of Rock and Roll All Night and throw the two parts into the crowd. Well, she was in the front row with her buddies, and she gets the neck, and she gave it to me for Christmas, man. So what a solid fucking move that was.
Yeah.
I opened it. I'm like, what? Because she's a Kiss fan. She didn't have to do that. It was a solid move, and there it is. But yeah, his DNA is on that fucking thing right there.
Paul Stanley's signature model. We're touching it. You don't have it in a fucking
Well, don't kid yourself. These are breakable.
Oh, of course they are.
They're not the real. He's got a stack of breakable guitars.
Sure. But I'm saying you being you, I thought this would be in a hyperbolic chamber.
I thought about it, but I thought, okay, get a grip, man. My DNA's mixed with his DNA now. It's all good.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's what that is.
So what, he played it for one song and then beat the shit out of it?
Oh, he doesn't even play it. He switches it.
Oh, he switches it
and then smashes it and the pyro goes off and Shout out to Melissa, man. It was...
Nice work, Melissa.
There you go.
Yeah, very cool.
Okay. Yeah. So, you tease the next show. The next show will be that thrash doc, Murder in the Front Row.
Murder in the Front Row.
We're going to talk about thrash and we're going to talk about that doc, and it's going to be awesome.
Yeah,
I love that genre.
This is a early 80s metal.
Created a genre of music, those fucking guys.
Sure did.
Unbelievable. Yeah. So, that's what we're going to do.
Very cool.
Cheers, buddy.
Okay, man.
Okay.
Over and out.
We're out. Peace out.
Kiss rules.
Woo!